And now, ladies and gentlemen, a conversation with PhRMA Leadership, moderated by Susan Dentzer. Please welcome to the stage Christopher Viehbacher and John Lechleiter.
Well, good morning, Chris and John. It's great to be here with you. This has been a fascinating conference, and I think we've heard three overarching themes that are sort of global issues and challenges, and then specific implications for the pharmaceutical and biotech industry. Number one, of course, being the scientific explosion, the fact that we really are on the verge of an enormous increase in knowledge. Governor Patrick talked about the investments that the state is going to make to advance those things. So we have that on the one hand, at the same time that we have funding challenges to fund research in a way that probably has never been the case before. We then have the notion of the world demanding now affordability of healthcare and value in healthcare, at the same time that much of what's in the pipeline in pharma is very high cost specialty medications. So a bit of attention there. And then finally, the notion that it's time to really ask the patient what the patient wants in care. The patient-centeredness now becoming a focus, and how the industry responds to that going forward, how it reconfigures perhaps what it is doing in order to meet those challenges. So to start with the first one, the knowledge explosion, the scientific opportunities being what they are, and yet the funding challenges to basically be able to mount those research activities. Chris, let's start with you. How does the industry confront this?
You know, I think the first thing is that we've kind of gotten away from talking a little bit about the promise of science because there was so much hype at the time when we had the decoding of the human genome, and everybody expected that, you know, the day after we decoded the human genome that, you know, everybody would be cured of cancer. And of course, there hasn't been that. It was an extremely important step that has led to other steps. But, you know, what's going on isn't one big project like that. It is a multiplicity of things. You know, there's regenerative medicine, there's gene therapy. We're understanding, you know, how DNA communicate with proteins, and I'm just throwing up targets everywhere. In a single year, the NIH developed over 1,800 new targets. And, you know, this is extremely important for us because, you know, most of our success in the 90s was really based on those targets that came out of research in the 70s and 80s. And we kept working with the same targets all the time, which is why the whole Me Too medicine approach was taken. And so now you're looking at this explosion of targets. It's opening up possibilities everywhere. And so that's exciting. At the same time, there is this funding problem. If you ask venture capitalists, say, well, you know, there's no IPO market opportunity. The timeline to develop a drug is way beyond what we want.
They have lots of other investment opportunities staring them in the face.
And if you talk to any venture capitalists, first thing they want is, how do I get out? And then if you then couple that with kind of a regulatory framework that's been uncertain, they've just decided those other opportunities are not there. Now that opens up an opportunity for us because, you know, the real secret of the pharmaceutical industry is that we really weren't doing a lot of the real basic research. We weren't doing the natural science experiments to really discover causes of disease or find a target. You give us a target, we'll give you a molecule. Now we're going much earlier in research and development, which is really what spring up all these collaborations that Tess was talking about yesterday. And the fact that there's this lack of funding means that we can actually fill a little bit of that gap, not only in terms of capital, but also in terms of some of our competencies. So oddly enough, I think the fact that the funding problem is not there and the fact that we're looking for new innovation is driving our, you know, various actors into each other's arms and collaborating in ways that didn't exist before. So that's why I think I shared Alexei's optimism. I think if we can come up with these new models, we can capitalize on these new opportunities.
John, as you take the baton from Chris, do you agree?
Well, I think that there's been a sort of an overarching sense of more optimism than pessimism in the day and a half that we've spent together. I think all of us see in some fashion the promise and the potential of the science and of what's going on in our laboratories currently. And I think if you look at the history of science, it's full of examples of where basic discoveries sort of take a while, or there's a lag period between the basic discovery piece and its application. So you could say biotechnology was born, let's say, in the 1970s, but you might say it was the 1990s before we began to realize the full promise of biotechnology. So those who are critical, and there are many who are critical of how much we've spent collectively on R&D in the last decade to produce sort of diminishing returns, I think are looking in the rearview mirror. We need to be looking out the front window and looking at some leading indicators too. I think one leading indicator is the fact that we have about 3,200 medicines today in clinical trials versus 2,400 in 2005. Now, not all of those are going to make it, but that's a 33% increase in 7 years. I'm encouraged by the kinds of partnerships we heard talked about over the last 2 days. I think we are discovering new ways in which government, academia, large companies, and small companies can work together. And I think that ultimately is the only way we're going to be successful. But I think we also, as enterprises, are all, you know, trying to find the secret sauce and trying to understand better how is it that we can transform or radically change some of what we do to better manage risk, to reduce timelines, and to reduce cost. Part of that answer has to come from changes in the regulatory process. I think the regulators, if they're able to provide greater certainty, if we're able to have greater certainty, if investors have greater certainty that certain pathways will lead to certain outcomes, and be assured that that process will work consistently and in a manner that's fair and science-based, I think that opens up a lot of opportunity, and that's one reason why the passage of PDUFA is so important to us. It's not the only thing, but I think it's one more step in that direction.
Well, from a policy perspective, in addition to ensuring the passage of PDUFA, renewal of PDUFA, what else would be on the industry's list, do you think, John, to engender those kinds of changes at the regulatory level that will meet the needs you described?
Well, a number of us have been involved with a study that was commissioned by the White House involving a PCAS, which is the President's Science Advisory Council. This is an effort led by Eric Lander of MIT that should culminate in a report in the next few months that aims to look rather more comprehensively at the, I guess, what we've called the ecosystem here the past several days. It's an effort that's involved a number of players from all spheres, including insurers and academicians and others, to try to you know, make that ecosystem work as effectively as possible to see that new medicines that do bring the right balance of benefit and risk get to the American public sooner and faster. So I think there's a recognition that there is a problem, and it's not just seen as a pharma industry problem, you guys go and solve it. I think it's seen as a societal problem. We lead the world in the kinds of basic research. As somebody said the other day, the NIH is without an equivalent anywhere else. We lead the world in terms of applied biomedical research, with our member companies spending $50 billion last year on R&D. So there are a lot of people out there saying, we'd like to see more out of that effort. How can we collaborate and try to achieve that?
Chris, when one talks to securities analysts who follow this industry, they've remarked upon the consolidation that has taken place in the industry in recent years and think potentially more is coming. Is there a mismatch between the number of organizations chasing this new science and the science, or are there enough opportunities to go around? How do you see the balance between the opportunities that exist in the scientific front and the number of companies pursuing them?
Well, I think there are enough opportunities to go around. That's not the issue. I think when you talk to investors, there's investors aren't generic. The investors in companies like Lilly and Sanofi aren't the ones who are investing in Alnylam here, for example. And our investors will never give you very much credit for what you have in your pipeline. And in fact, the day you launch a new product now, they start worrying about the patent expiry, 8, 9, 10 years later.
No good deed goes unpunished.
Absolutely. So you're left with a situation of, you've got a patent expiry in 10 years, but even if you have something in your pipeline, you're not going to get much credit for it. Now, that's partly because of the uncertainties of the regulatory process. It's certainly related to the uncertainties of getting these medicines reimbursed. But there is a real reluctance to give value for it. That puts us under huge amounts of pressure because we're all investing significantly. I mean, on average, pharma companies are investing between 15 and 20% of their sales. I mean, there isn't another single industrial sector that spends so much of their sales on R&D. Now, it puts pressure on us to find new models and try to keep the costs low. Some of us are dealing with diversifying revenue streams so that we can continue to invest in it. But equally, I think if you have later stage biotech companies, there's still plenty of money to go around. The real gap is at the level of the startups. And that's where I think we do have to find these new funding models that, you know, was talked about in yesterday's panel.
John, you were smiling a moment ago. What was making you smile?
Well, I think that the fact that there has been such consolidation, I think is pause for reflection to some extent, because when I joined the industry in the late 70s, I counted up about 30 companies at that time that had what we might call today global reach, at least in the terms of the early 1980s. And today there are about a dozen, so that the consolidation is real, and yet we have a flourishing, still flourishing, you know, sort of biotech community that we didn't have back then. But I think it's important, I want to say this in a careful way, but there was a New England Journal article last year on the subject of where do medicines come from. This is long debated. And if you read the story, I'm going to get the figures about right, depending on sort of where you look at the origin of drug A or drug B, something like 80 to 95% of medicines that ultimately get to patients come from our industry, from the biopharma industry. It doesn't mean we don't need the National Institutes of Health or Harvard University or any of the other players in this endeavor. It is an ecosystem, and we take advantage and seize opportunity based on basic research discoveries. But, you know, medicines come from biopharma companies. Kevin Scherer, the CEO of Amgen, said last year at a meeting Chris and I had with him that apart from statecraft, he said, I think the discovery and development and commercialization of medicines is maybe one of man's most difficult, most challenging endeavors. And I think we've got to be careful we don't oversimplify that process, and that we understand the importance of company formation and the importance of creating an environment that enables companies who have amassed this expertise to be able to build on that, because we all benefit when that happens.
Well, staying just on that theme, we know we're in an era where people are demanding greater affordability and value out of healthcare at a time when what the industry has in the pipeline are extremely important products, very sophisticated, that are high cost. How is the industry going to communicate this notion of value and get in touch with this discussion about affordability and value at a time that so much of what is in the pipeline is going to be so costly? Chris.
I think you have to come back to this whole notion again of making healthcare affordable. As John said, I mean, it is very complex developing a drug. Forbes, I think it was, had an article recently that looked at the cumulative spend of pharmaceutical companies over 10 years and divided by the number of products. And the actual, if you do it that way, you know, you could be spending anywhere from $5 to $10 billion to develop a new drug. Certainly, if you're going to develop a new drug, you've got to be able to meet a bar of showing value. Why is this new drug better than what's already on the marketplace? Not just in terms of value, but there's also a safety angle to it. But the reality is that, you know, we can't stop progress. We need new therapies. But if you look at how much money is being spent on healthcare, it's a very small fraction that's related to pharmaceuticals. We know that if we can get more prevention, if we can manage chronic disease better, I mean, somebody talked yesterday about the Asheville project. You know, we demonstrated that if you manage chronic diseases better, you can reduce costs by 30 to 40%. That's where you're going to make healthcare affordable. And then that creates the space within that to fund innovation. But I think to say, hey, we're not going to pay any attention to all of the waste and inappropriate spend in healthcare and focus on the things that are coming along that can really meet unmet medical needs, I think that's where we've got to really intervene in the debate.
The public is still averse to paying the cost. And this morning's New York Times has the story about efforts now to demand that insurers not tier a lot of the specialty products, or they keep copays low. Public doesn't seem to quite understand what all of this costs. How does one communicate clearly to the public? We do want these drugs. They are going to be paid for some way, somehow.
Well, the payment system today is where it is for a variety of reasons, but I think you could argue without too much difficulty that it is a bit skewed. I mean, if we believe, as I'm going to say in my talk in a few minutes, that medicines in many cases, and probably most cases, can offset other costs in the system, why would you want to tag a $50 copay onto a monthly prescription and give somebody who had surgery, the bill for the phone calls they made from the room? Okay, I mean, at the end of the day, you're subsidizing the 88%. And you're penalizing the 12, that's one of the few leverage points you've got to lower the 88. So if you gave me, America's cost dilemma, and you defined it in terms of here's medicines and here's all the other system costs, and I knew nothing about healthcare, but, was tackling this as an MBA project, I'd say, knowing that this 12 helps reduce the 88, I think I'll look at the 88. And figure out where can we eliminate waste and duplication and all the other things that make healthcare in this country today less efficient than we'd all like to see. Getting back though, Susan, to your question about value, I think there's a value check today on nearly every product we launch to get our products positioned on formularies, to enable us to compete against generics, which used to be our brands. We thought they were pretty good when we had them, okay? To be able to win in emerging markets where you may face very low-cost local competitors. So I think all of us today think about value from the very beginning of the process, but also must compete on that basis. It's not always so evident when somebody says, here's the list price, okay? But of course, you have to provide discounts. You have to provide, some incentive or some, data that gives a payer the confidence that this product does represent pretty good value. And of course, with 80% of prescriptions today in the U.S. are approaching that, being in the form of generics, American consumers have a pretty good deal when one balances those things out.
I was just going to say the same thing. I mean, you look, probably one of the most important classes of drug ever launched were statins. I mean, it's had a huge impact on cardiovascular mortality. Well, now you got Lipitor, you've got Zocor, you've got Mevacor. Walmart is selling those for $4 for a month's supply. Prozac had a big impact on mental health. You can buy that for $4 a month. Plavix from about 3 weeks from now is going to be available also for $4 a month. I mean, these are massive, massive improvements in healthcare that are available for almost less than a pack of cigarettes today. So, we wouldn't have been able to do that if all of that investment hadn't been done. And that's why I think we got to be careful in not ruining that innovation and destroying it. We have to be conscious of affordability, and I think, whether it's our partnership for prescription assistance and our copay programs, I mean, we're trying to do what we can on that. But I think people have to step back and say, if you look at all these healthcare interventions and you take the right approach, all of this investment has had a huge impact on productivity. Michael Milken and his institute calculates that at least 50% of the improvement in wealth and productivity over the last 100 years is related to clean water and medical advance. So, we got to make sure we keep everything in the right perspective.
I'm not sure you want to go with that advertising slogan that a prescription for Prozac today costs less than a pack of cigarettes. I'm not sure that's going to be the right.
Well, but it shows you where the priorities are.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, we shouldn't have packs of cigarettes out there for sale at all.
Another important discussion to have. Let's go to the third theme that I mentioned earlier, which is this notion of the patient at the center. Let's start with the conception of what is it that the patient wants? What is the value the patient seeks in healthcare? It kind of reminds you of the old Winston Churchill line that Americans always do the right thing after trying all the other alternatives. Now that we've tried every other approach, let's start with the patient and see how we can begin to think about a system around the patient and what the pharmaceutical company's role is in that. If in fact, as some people say, we're going to start from thinking about the standpoint of the patient, a lot of people in the industry are saying it's time to stop talking about product. It's not about product, it's about solutions for patients and how the industry reconfigures itself to think in the broadest possible way about providing those solutions and the holistic approach, in which, of course, the product is a piece, but it is a piece. Chris, as you think through that potential new reality, what comes to mind?
I think we are coming to the game late, but I think it's critical. I started my career at Burroughs Wellcome the day we launched AZT, and you know, this was the real emergence of patient advocacy in HIV. And you know, we started off fighting it. Our stands at medical congresses were trashed. We didn't have enough supply because the medicines were being made available as soon as you were out of phase two, and we were rationing, and patient advocacy groups wanted to know, well, how are you rationing these, and are these real product supply shortages and the like. And one day, we decided to stop fighting, and we decided to start working with them and said, they have a legitimate right to know how this, there should be transparency about how you're rationing. Instead of having the advocates chain themselves to the gates of our factories, as they did, we opened the factory gates and said, here's what we're doing. And guess what? They actually then were the ones that went to the FDA and said, you can't take us back in those days. It was taking over 3 years to get a new drug approved. Mm-hmm. And that was really what led to PDUFA, the first PDUFA, and we got all new drugs much faster. And guess what? We never had any problem in reimbursement. You know, we've tended to do is deal with the medical community or the government, but the people who really want to know what's going on with healthcare are people who are affected by it. This is not just any product. And I think the more we listen to patients, first, I think it makes good business because we will adapt our products to real patient needs instead of what we think are those patient needs. And two, they have just as much interest in making sure that new medicines come along, that those medicines are available as rapidly as possible through the regulatory process, and that those are accessible and affordable to everyone. So to me, it's a natural alliance, and we can both learn from that and actually benefit from that.
So what does that mean in terms of the industry thinking about how it structures itself going forward, John, in your view?
Well, I think it's going to take, we're sort of turning things on their head a little bit, and I think we have to do that. I've learned a lot just in the 4 or 5 years I've been coming here and meeting with patient advocates. And by the way, it's always amazing to me how less developed patient advocacy is almost everywhere outside the United States. It's in sort of early stages. In the U.S., I think we can again be a model for what advocacy can or should look like. I happen to believe that we could solve a lot of the problems in our healthcare system if we had truly empowered patients. I'm not sure everybody feels the same way. We've been disintermediated for many years from the people who use our products. As I think Chris or someone commented yesterday, we talk about, well, who's our customer? Is it the prescribing physician? Is it the payer? Is it the patient? Well, at the end of the day, it's the person that depends on our product for an outcome that they're looking for. And while we know many times our medicines are necessary, I think they're seldom sufficient. And any, if you need any evidence of that, the panel yesterday on adherence and compliance, those numbers are shocking. And this is the U.S. You know, this is not a developing country. So I think the challenge for us is, how do we build in the voice of the patient very early on? One of our development programs now, for the really the first time, we have the voice of the patient really, I think, informing us as we go through development. We need to replicate that. But then, you know, how do we better understand at the end of that process what the real patient needs are? What are the real world concerns of somebody who's using our insulin or who's taking Plavix? You know, and because at the end of it all of us who take medicines are looking for that medicine to be a means to an end. And the end may be prevention of disease, the end may be getting back to work, the end may be getting out of the hospital, the end may be seeing our granddaughter get married. And that's where we've got to, that's the direction. To me, it's a very clear direction we need to go in.
I think just to add on, I mean, I think there's a huge opportunity because healthcare is probably the worst consumer experience you'll ever have. You know, nobody really is starting with the patient saying, how do we help the patient? The patient gets passed from one specialty to another, to a hospital, to a pharmacy. We give them all this communication materials and labeling that, you know, could be, might as well have been written in Greek. And so I think there is a real opportunity also to tailor the system for a patient, and those that do, I think, will benefit.
Let's pretend for a moment that you both were patients. What would you say you find most exciting at this point about the way the industry is responding to patients? John?
Well, I think the movement toward personalized medicine, and I want to say one thing. I think, Chris, you mentioned this yesterday. If 75% of the cost drivers in our healthcare system are chronic disease, we can't walk away from chronic disease. But I think on the other side of that, even in certain chronic diseases like cancer, we know we can tailor medicines better today. So it may not be the right medicine for you, but it's the right medicine for me. That's very exciting, I think. That holds a promise of really maximizing that benefit-risk quotient for an individual patient. And I think that is clearly where things are going to go. I think in 20 years, there'll be many, many occasions when, as a healthcare consumer, you will have, and your physician will have, much more insight into why a particular medicine is more likely to work for you from the outset. Today, it's almost a coin toss in some cases, and that doesn't help the patient, and it certainly doesn't help the pharma industry.
As we close this conversation, let me ask you both in a crisp way. Let me ask you for the Twitter feed equivalent, 140 characters, if you will, or thereabouts. If we back here 10 years from now and reflecting back on the prior decade, and we complete the sentence, over this past decade, the industry has done X, that really addresses exactly the challenges that we've been talking about, but also very particularly the opportunities, John, especially that you just expressed, the personalized medicine opportunity. What would you say? We were able in this past decade to accomplish X, and that was good. Chris?
To dramatically reduced the incidence the cost of Alzheimer's disease, and to have dramatically reduced the mortality of cancer.
Not half bad for a decade's work, would it be? John?
Has finally translated the promising science from the genomics revolution into a plethora of useful medicines.
Again, that would be worthy activity for a decade of work. Well,
it's a big word. But we'll be retired in a decade, right? So,
but many more will be coming behind you. Inspiring comments from both of you. Thank you so much. And
thank
good
you.
Luck, John, as you take
Thanks,
over.
Susan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, this is the point in time where I have a big smile on my face, and John doesn't. So, John, I won't ask you to raise your right hand here, but we have a very useful tool here. Anybody stepping out of line on the board? Any problems with any kind of legislation, and you need to go see someone up on the hill? You will notice that this is actually not in pristine condition, that therefore that this has in fact been a useful tool. So I would like to say how honored it has been, what an honor it has been for me to be chairman of PhRMA and to be able to pass this gavel. I think over the course of this meeting, we really had a good dialogue about what our responsibility as an industry is. We all run companies, but healthcare matters to people. Yeah. And I would also just like to thank you, because we both run businesses. We both have to spend a huge amount of time running our businesses. You're always at every meeting. I'm always at every meeting. That shows a level of commitment to our industry. And I couldn't be more proud to hand you this gavel and congratulate you as the next chairman of the board of directors of PhRMA. So I'll pass you that.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate you. Have a photo. Okay, great. Well, now it's my turn to thank Chris, who served us not for 1 year, but for about 18 months with no extra pay. And he's done a terrific job helping guide PhRMA's efforts and helping to really guide the interests and the goals and aspirations of our member companies in an extraordinary way. And it's a lot easier for me to get to Washington than it is for you to come from Paris, but you were always there. You were always engaged, and I think you've helped not only build the team and support the team at PhRMA, but you've, I don't think we've ever had better alignment sitting around the room at our board, and I think a lot of that has to do with you and the tone you set. So thanks, Chris, and we have for you this wonderful and traditional bowl. I learned today that the manufacturer has gone out of business, so I'm going to get plexiglass next year if I live through the year. But this looks good on you, okay? Congratulations.
Thank you.
I can't believe students went out of business. Okay, thanks, Chris.
Well, I did actually have a few extra innings, and I would just like to just say a few words of thanks because, you know, clearly you serve your year as chairman, but we've done that. First of all, we all need to have an incredibly important and competent Washington office. You know, originally when I was going to when I moved on to the leadership track, I think I was supposed to be actually taking the gavel in your place at the time. But I came to the annual meeting 2 years ago expecting to become treasurer, and because of some other changes in the industry, said, oops, you're on the accelerated development program. Now you're vice president. And then I was vice president for about 9 months, and then suddenly, whoops, we need you to step up immediately to chair. And that put a huge pressure on our Washington office. We thought we had, you know, at least a year to prepare the program, and so I'm particularly grateful to Ed Greising, Patrick McLean, and Joe Devaney for their support in all of this. And of course, what you really realize as chairman is how much work is being done on our behalf by all of the PhRMA staff. It's been an enormous pleasure to be able to work with John Castellani. I think John has brought new leadership in a different approach. We wanted a more consensual approach. We wanted more stakeholder involvement, what we want to do. We wanted to become more of a thought leader and not just an advocacy group. And of course, we have to think very carefully about our finances. All of our companies under significant pressure. And I think John has also had the courage to take some very difficult decisions to both streamline the organization, but also reinforce our teams to make PhRMA an even more competent and more powerful organization. And finally, I'd like to thank all of my board colleagues. You know, the real day-to-day work of our business is in the committees. All of the committee chairs have a lot of meetings in addition to the board meetings. People are participating in the committees. And I think, as John said, I think we've had a degree of consensus and cohesion over the last 3-4 years around the board table that certainly we didn't see when I first joined the board 7-8 years ago. So I'd just like to thank all of my board colleagues for their support, all the PhRMA staff, and particularly the Sanofi Washington staff as well. And I'd like to thank all of you for your support and confidence. And wish John every success. It's been a pleasure working with John. You're a great leader, and I think the fact that you also bring a scientific background is extraordinarily important, because you know best what's really at the heart and mission of our business. So thank you very much, everybody.
That feel pretty good?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Chris, again, thank you so much. Good morning again, everyone. I hope you'll give me about 15 more minutes just to share some thoughts with you this morning before we go to our concluding speaker. And again, I just want to begin again by thanking Chris for his strong leadership of PhRMA. He's led us through a very challenging year and a half, again, with no extra pay, with no lack of significant issues on the domestic front or the international policy fronts. And Chris, you'll be a tough act to follow. I also want to thank John Castellani and our PhRMA staff and all the member company staff, many of whom are here, who champion the importance of innovative medicines for patients. I'm honored to represent this great organization and to assume this office in front of so many friends and colleagues who really do, at the end of the day, represent patients. I plan to continue to champion medical innovation in every way I can, and to help ensure that our companies can continue the heroic work of healing and saving lives well into the future. To succeed, we'll need all of us, PhRMA, our member companies, and all of you here present who understand the critical importance of our work to stand up for policies that support innovation, to continue to build trust with our stakeholders, and to get our powerful story out. Yesterday's date, it turns out, is famous in the annals of innovation. It was April 12, 1961, that Yuri Gagarin became the first human being to fly in space. On April 12, 1981, 20 years later, the Space Shuttle Columbia blasted off, launching the Space Shuttle program. But with no disrespect to our space programs, April 12, 1955 gave birth to an innovation that would have even greater human impact. On that date, the world heard one of the most eagerly anticipated announcements in medical history. Dr. Jonas Salk's polio vaccine worked. That vaccine turned a disease that once horrified America into a memory, and over time would do so for most of the world. The fact is, medical innovation over the past century, as we've heard this morning and earlier in this program, transform the basic expectations of human life that had prevailed pretty much since the dawn of civilization. Tens of millions of death sentences were lifted, and once dread diseases became chronic, manageable conditions. Take our progress against our two leading killers. The death rate from coronary heart disease in the United States has declined by about two-thirds since it peaked in 1968. There are 1 million Americans who lived last year, 1 million, who would have died in 2011 at the 1960s rate. And the American Cancer Society says that from 1991 to 2007, the death rate for all cancers dropped 17%. Over 100,000 more people in this country are alive every year because of this decline. The cumulative impact of the medical innovation of the past century is nothing short of mind-boggling. In 1900, the average American life expectancy was 47. In 2000, it was 78. That's an increase of 66% in one century, and that's unprecedented in human history. Folks, the industry we represent is a big reason we've gained these extra decades. An analysis by Columbia University professor Frank Lichtenberg found that the launches of new medicines accounted for 40% of the increase in life expectancy during the 1980s and 1990s alone. That's 5 months of every additional year. And people, as we know, are not only living longer, they're living better. A 2006 study found that from 1982 to 2005, the prevalence of chronic disability among elderly Americans dropped by more than 25%. This certainly jibes with our own experience. We all know people in their 70s and even 80s, and in John Castellani's case, in their 90s, who left behind rocking chairs for sea kayaks and cross-country skis. And while we're all frustrated with the rise in overall healthcare spending, a big chunk of that must be due to the fact that these folks are now healthy enough to get a knee replacement or a coronary bypass or cancer treatment in their 70s and 80s and continue their active lifestyle, which sounds a lot better than the alternative to me. If the sole impact of biopharmaceutical innovations was additional decades of life and health, we'd be hard-pressed to find their equals. But the economic payback from these gains is also difficult to overstate. The payback is years of productive work, economic value added, consumer spending, and yes, tax dollars paid, which together outweigh the costs of treatment overwhelmingly, even if you resist putting a number on the intrinsic value of being alive. There's also compelling evidence that innovative medicines are the most cost-effective part of healthcare. A few years ago, Medco CEO David Snow, I guess former Medco CEO David Snow, visited Lilly. He reminded us that Americans with chronic and complex diseases, as we just discussed, account for 75% of U.S. healthcare spending, and that nearly 90% of the time, medicines are the first choice for medical intervention. One example David used was diabetes. He said in studies Medco had done, it cost half as much to treat patients with diabetes who adhered to their prescribed course of medicine compared to those who didn't. And last year, as many of you know, the Journal of the American Medical Association reported that when seniors who did not have comprehensive prescription drug coverage received coverage through Medicare Part D, they saved an average of $1,200 per year in hospital, nursing home, and other medical costs. Now that translates into $12 billion per year in savings across Medicare. David Snow summed it up well. He said, "Drugs used properly are part of the solution and not part of the problem." Now, because of our track record of innovation, some take ongoing progress for granted, or maybe even think we have all the innovation that we need. But we must build upon and not rest upon the contributions of the past. For all our tremendous progress, much, much more remains to be done. With 10,000 of us American baby boomers turning 65 every day, it's not surprising we're seeing a sharp increase in the incidence of diseases associated with aging. Thank you. It's not surprising we're seeing an increase in diseases associated with aging: cancer, type 2 diabetes, osteoporosis, neurodegenerative diseases, and more. The Alzheimer's Association says that by 2050, absent effective treatments, more than 13 million Americans will be afflicted by Alzheimer's. Costs in the U.S. alone could surpass $1 trillion a year, with a T. Let's face it, the only way to make further inroads against these and other conditions is to sustain medical innovation. The good news is that advances in the life sciences are bringing treatments once beyond our reach finally into view. One need look no further than the 36 new molecular entities approved by the FDA last year. As John Castellani reminded us yesterday, they include two novel personalized medicines, one for lung cancer, another for melanoma, 11 new medicines for rare diseases, two breakthrough medicines for hepatitis C, and the first new medicine for treating lupus in more than 50 years. And I'm proud to say many of these came from pharma member companies. Just last week, the FDA approved a Lilly imaging agent designed for use with PET scans to detect for the first time beta amyloid plaques in the brains of patients who are being evaluated for suspected Alzheimer's disease and other causes of cognitive decline. Now, as a scientist myself, or maybe a recovering scientist, I believe that the juxtaposition of new insights into human biology, just as you heard from our panel yesterday, coupled with the application of new tools and advanced technologies, has the potential to revolutionize our business more in the next 10 years than in the past 50. That is, if we don't stop the revolution cold in its steps. As we know, the bar for innovative medicines is rising inexorably higher. Many of the diseases we're tackling have defied treatment throughout human history. Costs per drug have skyrocketed, and with the exception of 2011, new drug approvals have trended downwards, not upwards. And we're in the midst of a five-year period when some $150 billion of branded pharmaceutical products lose patent protection. Now, this is great news for consumers, but it translates into $150 billion less annual revenue for the industry as a whole to invest in R&D. Partly as a result of these forces, over the past 20 years, 26 major independent pharma companies have consolidated into 9. So here's our challenge. What can we do to ensure that we are able to sustain the innovation required to conquer diseases, control costs, and maintain the trajectory of longer, healthier lives? How do we win the case that what we do is, in David Snow's phrase, part of the solution? Let's look first at what we need to do to shape our external environment, and second, what we as an industry must do ourselves. When it comes to healthcare policy, we need to speak up for policies that sustain and encourage innovation and against those that would undermine it. What we've heard referred to as an ecosystem of innovation has at least four important elements. First of all, intellectual property protection. Second, open access to healthcare markets. Third, market-based pricing. And lastly, a regulatory system that keeps pace with the 21st century science. Each of these elements is indispensable. And when we see them under attack, we need to stand our ground and call out the potential consequences. For example, we believe that doctors and patients must remain the ones to choose in an informed way from all available treatment alternatives. This is why we call, one reason why we call for the repeal of the Independent Payment Advisory Board. IPAB's goal may be to slow the growth of healthcare spending, which we agree with, but a board that focuses only on cost cutting, not on quality and health outcomes, has dangerous or potentially fatal consequences for patients and for biopharmaceutical research. We must continue to speak out against government price controls in Medicare Part D. These would, in effect, constitute a new $100 billion tax on the biopharma industry and would have serious and possibly disastrous consequences on many levels. For patients, the proposed price controls would put access to medicines at risk and have the unintended consequence of increasing other Medicare costs, including the insurance premiums paid by enrollees. I'm likewise concerned about the harm to innovation. Add an additional $100 billion to the $150 billion in revenue we're losing due to patent expirations, you're looking at potentially 200 medicines that will be delayed or never developed at all. And we need to continue to partner with the FDA and other agencies to develop and refine a regulatory process that is timely, predictable, consistent, transparent, and scientifically rigorous. PDUFA 5 provides a great opportunity to address some of our concerns and is a top priority for PhRMA and for me in this year ahead. But if we're to be seen as credible advocates, and if we're to have our voice heard and understood, we must do more. We must live out our values and continue to build trust in our industry and in what we do. A key step, of course, is to adhere to the codes that we've developed and put in place. Those codes have to do with interactions with healthcare professionals, clinical trials, the publication of clinical trials, health outcomes research, and direct-to-consumer advertising. All five of those require that we hold ourselves to the highest ethical standards, that we provide useful information and educate about both the benefits and risks of our products, that we remain constantly vigilant about product safety, and be transparent about our business practices. These guidelines are important, and they've helped improve our industry's image and our standing. For them to remain effective, all of us need to be diligent in following not only the letter, but the spirit of these codes. In addition, we need to do a better job than ever of getting our story out and making our case with force and frequency. I'll admit, our arguments don't fit on a bumper sticker, not one that I've seen, but there's certainly a compelling logic to them. Name a product that creates greater value than one that provides potential months, years, even decades of precious life. Hint, it ain't an iPad. In addition, treatments for many of today's seemingly unsolvable diseases will most likely come from labs like ours. And for a growing number of conditions, innovative medicines are not only the most medically effective, but also the most cost-effective treatments. But logic alone is insufficient. I think we all know that. We need to make our stories human and personal as we build our case. In this room, in the halls of Congress, in the offices of our customers, there's not one of us who hasn't been touched by the power of medicine, who doesn't have a story. In fact, I'd like to close with one. Last month at Lilly, many of us received an email from a Lilly colleague who works in information technology at our subsidiary, M-Clone, in New Jersey. It begins, "I'm sitting here looking out my window over New Brunswick, and I have a great view, in my opinion. Most people would see tall buildings, railroad tracks, and office buildings and highways in the distance. I see life. Cars driving by, the train going back and forth carrying hundreds of passengers, people walking along the sidewalk. Life." She reveals that she had been diagnosed with acute myelogenous leukemia, but she says, "I'm strong, a warrior, and I don't want a single one of you to worry about me for a minute." Then she writes this, "Here is what I want from you. In addition to going home and appreciating your family and loved ones more than ever, I want you to do your jobs. In IT, we often get locked into our day-to-day jobs. I would often forget that I worked for a company that does oncology research. But we do. Your job is every bit as important as one of our scientists doing research. Let that sink in, and don't forget it. I will never walk through the office doors again without remembering what we do at M-Clone. As a company, as a family, we have awesome jobs. And make no mistake, I will be walking through those office doors again. I can think of no better tribute to our colleague than for all of us to do our jobs, to stand up for the policies that foster innovation, to continue to build trust in our industry by earning that trust, and to proudly tell our story, all to preserve the innovation that's at the heart of what we do and that people are counting on us to deliver. So I appreciate so much the honor, and it is an honor and a privilege, to represent a group of people who devote their lives to alleviating suffering, inspiring hope, and providing additional years of precious life to millions of people around the world. Thank you ever so much.